listeners. As we wrap up season one of Introvert Ally, I want to express my appreciation to all of you who have listened and shared and rated the podcast. It means so much. I hope you enjoyed listening in on our conversations from a wide variety of accomplished introverted leaders. I believe that we can be better allies when we understand the many nuances of introversion. To help me reflect on some of the key takeaways from this inaugural season, I invited my partner, husband, and muse, Dr. Bill Kahnweiler, to the studio. Many of you know that Bill has been an inspiration for my work. He is the introvert I have been married to for almost 50 years now, who also identifies as a curmudgeon. Bill also happens to make me laugh on a daily basis and exudes humility to me and others. I asked him to join me on this recap episode to share what he took away from this season. In addition to being my husband, which is a job in itself, Bill Kahnweiler is a baby boomer with a varied work history, from director of a peer counseling program in a high school, college teacher in state and federal prisons, and an HR professional in a Fortune 10 corporation, to a human resource management consultant in a global firm. Before retiring from Georgia State University in Atlanta, where he was a professor of human resource development, his research focused on participative leadership, innovative career development practices, and system-level interventions designed to maximize organizational and individual effectiveness. Bill taught a wide variety of courses that focused on the human aspects of work organizations to undergraduate, master's, and PhD students. Bill says he intentionally tried to learn along with his students and probably learned more than they did. The most meaningful compliment he received from hundreds who endured his classes, as he says, was the funniest professor ever. He also learned the rarely, if ever expressed, major purpose of higher education is to employ the otherwise unemployable, most assuredly, including him. Side note, you can see some of his humility creeping in there. Hey, Bill, how you doing this morning?
Hey, Jennifer. Doing fairly well. How are you?
Great. We found the secret to our long marriage. People ask us, how have you stayed married for 50 years? Plus living together, right? And one of them is to actually do Zoom calls from different rooms in the house. Would you agree?
Yes. And I would also say limit the number of Zoom calls that we're on together.
Yeah. Well, this counts as the one for the day. And right?
At least a day, if not a week.
And another thing I know about you as my introverted spouse is that you do not like birthdays. And today happens to be your birthday. So I don't want to overdo it and get too excited, but I do want to wish you a happy birthday.
Okay.
Is Thanks. That my one?
That's it.
You're welcome. Is that my one for the day?
You've used your allotment.
Okay. Well, I better be very conscious of that. All right. So in all seriousness, I do appreciate you coming on the Introvert Alley podcast to wrap up season one. And just to tell our listeners why Bill is here, in addition to being my spouse, you are my partner through all these years in terms of being a sounding board for my work. And actually the reason I got into this work, which is a whole nother story, which I've mentioned in many contexts, but today is about getting your perspective. You're a loyal listener. You've actually listened to all of the podcasts. Thank you. The way you've read all my books, and I want to give you a shout out for that. And you have been able to hold me accountable, to give me new insights. As an extrovert writing about introverts, you have been my rock and my honest feedback person. And you bring a perspective to this that is always enlightening to me. So what I thought we could do today is just talk about the different podcasts episodes that we had this first season and get your views on them. How does that sound?
Worth a try. Let's do it.
All righty. So why don't we dive in with episode number one with Dr. Scott Barry Kaufman. And tell me a little bit about what you got from that podcast. You recall, just maybe for our listeners who didn't listen to everyone like you have, what did you remember, or what resonated with you about what Dr. Kaufman shared the cognitive psychologist who is written so much and is well-versed in many areas of personality?
Well, I've always been interested in personality theory and that aspect of psychology. And also from way back when you and I were quite a bit younger than we are now, was always a fan of humanistic psychology. And I think Dr. Kaufman identified himself as a humanist in general and a humanistic psychology professional in particular. So that definitely attracted me.
If for those folks not familiar with humanistic psychology, could you describe just your view of what that is?
I think it looks at human potential. It's more of a positive view of human nature than some other psychological perspectives that focus on or emphasize problems that people have, deficiencies, things they need to eradicate or improve upon. Whereas this, I think, takes more of the people are essentially good and have great potential to be even better throughout their lifetime.
So, Bill, what was a key point that you took away that you resonated with there or didn't resonate with?
One that I did, he was citing the Big Five personality theory and framework, where if people don't know, I'm not an expert in that by any stretch of the imagination, but it condenses five traits on a continuum, each of them on a continuum that describes and explains different personalities and things like conscientiousness, neuroticism or lack thereof, agreeableness, I think is another one, and introversion, extroversion is one of the five.
Yeah, he also, I think, talked about, I'm sorry, open to experience.
Yeah, I think that was the other one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I've never been a big fan of the Big Five, even though I haven't studied it extensively. I've never, rarely, if ever, have had a problem having an opinion about something that I'm not knowledgeable about.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
But the thing on the introversion, extroversion dimension, again, one of the five personality factors in this theory. Maybe I'm interpreting it incorrectly, but in each of these factors, I think at the extremes, one extreme is good or positive or healthy, and at its other extreme is negative or unhealthy or deficient. So then I make, for me, a small step from that point that introversion is not good and not healthy, and extroversion is good and healthy at their extremes. Again, these are on a continuum. So it's not one or the other.
What concerns you about that, Bill? What concerns you about or makes you not connect
to? Yeah. And this is very personal to me, too, because I didn't even know what introversion was, much less that I was an introvert. But being raised in a household of extroverts, one way or another, I got the message that because I was quiet and didn't talk much and wanted to be alone a lot, that there was something wrong with me and that I needed to fix that. I needed to straighten up and fly right. And I don't know about any of your listeners, but I haven't found changing a core part of my personality to be something very simple, even if I wanted to change it. So anyway, I could be wrong about that. I probably need to get Dr. Kaufman's feedback on my own rudimentary understanding of the Big Five. But having I and E as one of the continua, that's my problem with it. That it suggests that I is not healthy and not good.
Yeah. And so what are you, what's the assessment or the theory that was, is more compatible for you? Is it the Myers-Briggs Jung-based theory?
Yes. That's how I first found out I was an introvert, that you and I were in graduate school at the time, and some of our peers, I think they were other older students, not necessarily professors, were getting into the Myers-Briggs. And then I think you told me about it in more detail. And as I read literature on it, it really resonated with me, like, aha, insight, I'm an introvert.
Yeah, and I always talk about the fact that it helped our relationship, at least back then, right? To have that lens.
Well, I think Myers-Briggs always claimed that one of its benefits is that it helps people understand each other better, especially if they're not similar in personality.
Right, right, exactly. Okay, so Dr. Kaufman's episode was very helpful. Do you think you found that you resonated with the humanistic psychology perspective that he had, and you take some exception to the Big Five theory? Was there anything else you wanted to share about his discussion?
Just that he came across as a extremely compassionate man,
mm-hmm.
which I would hope, if one professes to be a humanist, that would be evident.
Right, and his connection, even if it was posthumously, to
Maslow,
right, is very impressive. He writes extensively about that in his book Transcendence, which I highly recommend to our listeners. So thanks, Bill, for that view of our first kickoff episode, and then we moved into a discussion with HR pro and leader and self-proclaimed introvert who shared that with us, Pat Waters. So what, having been in HR yourself and taught HR courses, what about Pat's interview stuck with you, or what did you take away as one of my loyal listeners?
Well, at least a couple of things. I very much like how she expressed herself. She was very clear and seemed to have a quiet confidence. And as you know, Jennifer, people who are listening don't, but I haven't had a rich history of getting along with bosses well. I'm pretty unmanageable by nature. But as I listened to her on your podcast, I thought, she's somebody that I think I might be able to work for, you know, and not get frustrated, not get angry at.
And why? Why would you?
I don't know. She just seemed very open-minded and, you know, kind of a seeking to understand others and build on their strengths, as one of your book's subtitles was.
Right.
If I did have a manager, that's the kind of manager I wanted. I think she also, what I found favorable, she mentioned, didn't get into a lot of specifics, but that she has tried to integrate introversion into various fundamental HR processes and functions like hiring and compensation and other reward systems, and the fact that the organization probably has close to, if not half, the employee population being introverts, to try to be sensitive to that and integrate that into the design and execution of basic HR functions, you know, recruiting, hiring, motivating, compensating.
Yep. Definitely a leader in that field, and is one of the best practices we highlighted in the last book, Creating Introvert-Friendly Workplaces. She also, you mentioned to me offhandedly that questions are your best friends, that she talked about questioning.
Yeah, I liked how she put that, because an introvert myself, I try to ask a lot of questions when I meet people, or you know, when I was working with clients. And certainly as a researcher, in the hallowed halls of academe, curiosity and questioning, I think is a fundamental perspective and a fundamental skill that one has to have to conduct decent research and to keep asking questions.
And a strength of introverts, I might add.
You would know better than I, but it takes the focus off me.
Ah, okay.
Also.
Yeah.
Because as an introvert, of course, I need time to think when people ask me questions. You know, let me get back to you tomorrow or in an hour. Or even you and I have talked many times, of course, about many things. And you'll tell me, you'll ask me a question or sometimes four in the same sentence.
Really?
And I need time to process it. And because I want to try to respond thoughtfully, not impulsively.
Right, exactly. And that's also a skill, by the way, at networking too, isn't it? That you can ask questions and put the lens off yourself. As long as people get to know you too, there's a balance to that. All right, so let's move on to episode number 3, which was Ryan Jenkins. And I know you had some thoughts about Ryan's discussion.
Yeah, one was just an opinion of mine, not necessarily fact, but he talked very rapidly. He was very articulate also, as I think you are. And that challenged me with one of my assumptions about introverts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that all introverts are like me. They talk very slowly, sometimes frustratingly so to others. You know, that you and our two daughters, we've had many, many instances over the years of, Dad, come on. We don't have all day.
You think you're done, like now, when I'm talking with you, right?
All right, you think I'm done, and you guys are on to 14 other new topics, and I'm still on the first one. I think a very helpful distinction that he made was between seeking solitude and being lonely. And I think probably a lot of people, especially some introverts, I suppose, you can tell me if you disagree, but can be in a room full of people and feel loneliness.
Yes, yes. Sophia said that too in her interview.
Yeah, I think so.
So yes, right.
But solitude is something that as an introvert I seek, but I guess a corollary of loneliness would be to over-isolate. That's not healthy. Then I'm in my head, which is where I want to be a lot of the times. But at the same time, if I'm in there too long, it's not healthy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that I was really glad that he made that distinction. And he gave some really helpful tips, too. I could have used these back in my younger days. How to talk to strangers. And why that's important to do, to open up to new experiences, new perspectives, potentially new relationships, meaningful relationships.
Or not, right? He said these could be just one time talking to your Uber driver. And I thought that was really interesting. The research is so compelling there about like, it just makes you feel better, you know, to connect with people. That's the name of his book, Connectable. Great. So Ryan was as a millennial, very high energy person who, you know, really challenged your view of what an introvert is. Right? It isn't one size.
Yeah, and a stereotypes, which my view is stereotypes are somewhat true, or they wouldn't be stereotypes, but they're not always true for sure.
They're based on some truth, but okay. So then we moved on to thank you for that and Tony Bond. Tony is an executive with Great Place to Work, and there are a couple points there that you tell me you really connected with.
Yes. One was, I think, when he was describing his childhood or parts of his childhood, and he was in a home of extroverts. So he was different than everybody in that respect. And I certainly resonated with that because I had the same exact experience as a child. I was the only introvert in a family of five, two sisters and my parents. And some of the challenges that that brought on.
What was a challenge for you?
Well, as I think I indicated earlier, I got the message, whether it was intended or not, and it probably wasn't intended by my parents, my father in particular, who was highly extroverted, that something was wrong with me. Or they would have friends come over to the house, and I didn't talk much, if at all, to them. And my parents were not cool with that. They interpreted that as being impolite and discourteous and disrespectful. And I just didn't have anything to say to their friends. It wasn't like I was trying to be a jerk. So that's just one example.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah, because the self-awareness, I mean, the related to a family, being related to a family of extroverts, I think I also heard in that interview, if I recall, Tony also talked about that it had a positive impact on him seeing strong women step in because his father was ill from a very early age. So it's never like one or the other, right? And he found his way in sports. He found his way in performance, you know, like a lot of people do. They learn ways to cope. But you relate personally to the fact that, you know, trying to find your space, your place in a family of extroverts. But let's move on to Jill Chang from Taiwan, who wrote a book about, you know, quiet is a superpower. And you tell me privately, I've talked to you about Jill throughout the years. What was it that you really connected with there or had a comment on?
Well, she gave one example. I think she was attending a conference. She might have even been had a program at one of them. And there was, I don't remember if it was a networking event or just people leaving a program and out in the hallways and, you know, a lot of buzz and a lot of talking and everything. And she, you know, bolted to her hotel room. She just needed to be away from people and to seek the solitude of being by herself in that room, at least for a while. And I very much resonated with that because I've done the same thing at conferences and other events. And it wasn't as if I was, not getting something out of the conference or felt that any of the conversations I was having with people, informal conversations, were boring or useless or a waste of time. I just needed to recharge.
I'd like to just add one thing there about Jill. She, as a business development person, salesperson, she went another step. She went to a very important step, which I also heard from Steve Persanti, the editor and former founder of, or founder of Barrick-Kohler Publishers, when he had to do the same thing at conferences. She took that break, but do you remember what she did then? She went and looked at who she wanted to meet with and scheduled, reached out to them individually. And
yes,
set meetings.
That's
with, right. So it connects to the sweet spot there of introverts. And I've seen you do that with one-on-one conversations. You know, when I run into your former students, they'll tell me how you spend time with them one-on-one. And that's where you develop the relationships, right?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. And even in social situations that you and I attended, there might be 30 people at a party, and you and I might be there for, I don't know, 3 hours, and I may have talked to a quarter of the people. And I'm not alone. I'm not seeking solace in the bathroom or something for an hour. It's just I got in deeper with fewer people.
Right, exactly. I remember.
I don't need to tell you, it's a hallmark of introversion.
Right. And one time we were at a dinner, I don't know if you remember that. And I was like, this woman just had your ear and I could see you were just getting bored at a table. And I said, afterwards, I said, Bill, why didn't you try to break away? And you go, I didn't know how to do that. And I said, always use the, I said to you, go to the bathroom. Always say you have to go to the bathroom, and that kind of breaks that. Or excuse me, I got to go somewhere. But, you know, I think sometimes it's hard for my introverted clients and colleagues to figure out a way to extricate themselves from those conversations. But
yes, I've had that experience too.
Yeah, there are tips about that, right? So great. So we've talked about, you know, Scott and Pat and Ryan, Tony, let's move on, and Jill. And then the last few episodes then went into talking with Doug Conan, which was also another highlight. And, you know, Doug is a leadership guru who's one of the first introverted leaders who, what I call it, is declared his introversion or came out. So what was a point there that really... Like if you were to say from his interview, what was one thing that really stood out for you?
Well, there were several, of course, but...
Can you pick one?
Yeah, I've got one for sure. Just give me a little second.
Okay.
As you know, part of my career was working with managers to try to help them become better managers. And... In my academic career, some of my research and teaching involved that too. But I had never really heard anyone until I heard Doug talk about leading by listening. Very simple sentence, but I think a very profound statement. And sure, people who were attending management training or something, they might have done a small portion of that on, you know, the importance of listening. But leading by listening, I think, even goes beyond that.
Yeah, I agree. And from a CEO, right? You don't think of a CEO doing that.
No, a CEO of a large company, too. Two large companies that he was the big Kahana. I also got a strong sense from him of his humility. I don't know how many CEOs or other C-level executives in large corporations, at least in our country, headquartered in our country, would be described as humble. But I got the strong sense that he was, which I deeply appreciate, too. I also really liked, and I say really liked because I believe this all for years myself, he said to get, you know, getting fired or laid off or downsized or whatever euphemism you want to use, it is personal. You know, we hear a lot about it. Well, it's a business decision. You know, it was impersonal. Well, anybody who has gotten let go, and I have, you know, I took it very personally. I was very upset about it. So I appreciate him validating that. And challenging that, I guess, maybe fairly longstanding view that it's just business.
Yeah. And right. An introverted leader, humble, declared it early on in his tenure as a leader. And you connected with that for, you know, another person we probably would have liked, both of us like to have as bosses, right?
I think so.
I know so.
At least I was willing to give it, I would be willing to give it a try. I also, just one more thing that Doug, I think, harped on for quite a while, I think it was towards the end of the podcast, that it's up to one as an introvert to ask for help and to say what you need, rather than what might be more natural for some introverts anyway, to you know, quietly sit and wait for somebody to ask how they can help, that you have to take the initiative and maybe beyond the initiative, keep stating what you need and what you don't need and for the benefit of yourself and the organization you're working in.
I think it goes beyond asking for help. It's saying, are as an introvert, people can't be mind readers. I think with the lens of this podcast, we're talking about, you know, how do we step up? How do we claim who we are? I think what you're also saying is it has to be, the term now used a lot is psychological safety, right? About you know, having a climate where you can do that, where you don't have to cover and pretend you're an extrovert, you know, and you could feel, you can say, look, I need a break now, right? Or I need to work at home today. That used to be a big deal to try to do that, right? And working on this project, any solitary time.
Thank you. I would agree.
Would agree. Yay, we agree today.
That in itself is a revelation.
That is, that we should end the podcast right here. Okay, Sophia Demling. Now, Sophia is somebody you've also met. Some of these colleagues of mine and have become friends, and you met her virtually. I know you have a lot of respect for her. And so say why that is, why you first felt like she, you know, being an INTJ, some of you know that, Bill, is, you know, you could say you value competence. Is that right?
Extremely so.
Yeah. And she was one of those people, I think you told me, that thought was very competent.
Absolutely. In many ways. And I guess when I first crossed paths with her, I felt that she was an excellent writer. And I've always valued people who display that skill. And she has that. I very much appreciated also how she distinguished between introversion and shyness. And I know that you, Jennifer, and in your work and in your books, have done that too.
What was it about what she shared?
I think it's a very important distinction to educate people about. I think some people might look at it as socially awkward, or that, you know, other people scare you or make you extremely nervous. And not to beat a dead horse, but introversion, at least to me, and I think to her also, as well as your other podcast guests, that it's where you prefer to get your energy and how to re-energize, a preference for how to do that. I think she may have even said some extroverts could be shy. I don't know if I've ever met any. Though I may be trapped in my own stereotypes about that, but there are shy introverts for sure, but there are not shy introverts also. And so I think she debunked a stereotype that some people may have about those two things.
Mm-hmm.
So it leads to greater understanding, and who's not for that? I sure am. I think she made a very important point about how important it is, I guess, for every human, but especially we introverts who tend to want to spend a lot of time by ourselves, to have a strong support system no matter what's going on in our life. And certainly in instances like hers, where she suddenly lost her partner and soulmate and husband of, what, 40 years or something like that, suddenly, unexpectedly, that her support system, her true and good friends, have been invaluable.
Mm-hmm.
But as I said, I think that's also true when you don't have such a devastating loss.
And I've observed you as an introvert have a strong circle of support and friends too. And I think a lot of people think that introverts don't have a lot of friends, but those relationships,
they may.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess I'm maybe a textbook introvert in that respect, that I've always had friends, but I've had fewer friends and I'm closer to them than compared with some other people who have more so-called friends, but they're not as deep relationships.
Yeah. And when you think about it, it's really been helpful that we each have our own separate circles of friends too. You know, as another aspect of marriage is like, you want to have your own support systems, not just rely just on your spouse for that.
Yes.
And so I think a lot of introverts, and you said textbook introverts, have deeper friendships. And I've seen that with both Sophia and you, in terms of being able to rely on those people, and particularly, as she said, you know, during that this really challenging time for her, you know, that she's got people she can, her people, she's got her people.
Yeah, and I was glad for her that she has that.
Yeah, I totally agree. And then rounding out our season one, we had Matt Pollard, who we had on the podcast because, you know, Matt is, he's a go-getter and a salesperson. He's written a lot about that. He speaks about, you know, sales and building entrepreneurial ventures as an introvert. So what was a point or two that you took from that one or that you reacted to?
I think a point that he repeated several times, I think, and he must really emphatically believe it, and I don't disbelieve it, is how some introverts can self-sabotage with two words, I can't.
Mm-hmm.
Well, three, and then fill in the blank. I can't sell. I can't network. I can't schmooze. I can't build relationships, whatever you want to fill in the blank. And I think that tends to be true, that, you know, telling oneself, I can't do this is very different than I don't want to do it, or I feel uncomfortable doing it, or I just feel very self-conscious doing it. But it doesn't mean you can't.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go back to the old Myers-Briggs analogy. It's like writing with your non-dominant hand. You can do it,
mm-hmm.
but it's going to take a lot more concentrated and conscious effort. You're going to feel awkward for a while. It takes practice. One of your four B's, mm-hmm. by the way. So I thought that was a helpful thing for him to point out on multiple occasions. I liked his term, the introvert hangover, which I guess I go back to Jill Chang about, you know, I've been with all these people at this conference and my head's exploding and I need to be by myself for a while. I don't know if he would agree that that was a hangover, but I link those two things together.
Yeah, that's a great term. That's a great
that
term.
You're just, you know, people exhaustion.
Right, and knowing yourself and knowing, you know, right, when to take those breaks. And I think you, when you and I first met, I wasn't really sure about what was going on when you would disappear. Now I know. Well, I think I know, maybe not. But I know that's a part of your DNA.
Or we would have, you know, your parents or my parents staying with us.
Uh-huh.
And I would be in my home office with the door closed. And I would hear people in another part of the house say, where's Bill? Where'd he go?
Where's Bill? Where's Bill? That became, instead of where's Waldo, where's Bill?
Yeah.
Where's Bill? okay, finally, in rounding out our season, we had Tanya Vaughn. Tanya in the corporate world for a number of years, which I thought was an interesting choice for an introvert being in marketing. Although she's data analytics side of it, but she still has to, you know, be in that kind of a culture. And you having worked in corporate as well, what would you say struck you about her comments?
I think she said a number of times about being intentional,
mm-hmm.
Which maybe is an overused buzzword these days. But what I took from that was you have a plan. So, and that was one of your four P's too, right? So if you're making a presentation, not only to plan the content, but how to plan, and you can't plan everything, obviously. You don't know what's going to happen. But to plan, you know, different scenarios of how that presentation, that meeting may take place. And I think she also tied into that a willingness to be vulnerable, which I think can be helpful, especially to introverts, and to be transparent in that vulnerability, that it's okay to not know, it's okay to be unsure about something, it's okay to be confused.
I was going to say, and as she is an introvert and as a Black woman in a corporate culture, that even has more significance, don't you think?
I can only imagine, and maybe not even that well as a white man, but I think she's probably living with that all the time.
Mm-hmm. And showing courage.
Yes, very much so.
Yeah.
It's okay to be scared. I think she just mentioned something. I think she called them listening tours.
Mm-hmm. There's that word again, right?
Right. It was infected. Doug Conant's thing about leading by listening, but where my understanding of her explanation of those was exactly what that term says. Just listen. No talking. Don't ask questions yet. Just listen.
Listen.
You know this as well or better than I do, Jennifer. There are times as an introvert, I'm not listening very well. I'm getting ready to say what I want to say. I can't do that and listen very well at the same time. Maybe others can. So that tells me, you know, I still have work to do on listening.
And I have that on tape.
Oh,
I'm
going to
play this through the speakers in the house through Alexa.
I think I'm going to call a lawyer after this recording is finished. I'm going to need some help.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Not until we have our anniversary party, Bill.
All right.
Yeah, listen. No. So actually, this conversation, I want to thank you for your comments today and your insights. I knew that it would be terrific to hear from you about, you know, your view as one introvert. As you say, you can't generalize, but putting it through your lens as allies in supporting introverts in the workplace and advocates, you know, for speaking up to correct some of the real inequities that we have in our organizations that still exist. I think it's important that we continually, as extroverts, as introverts, listen to people with different personality types and also know that there is not one introvert, one type of introvert, right? And I think, you know, that's what I got from our episodes and our season, that we heard so many different perspectives, including your own. So I'd love to hear, is there anything else that you want to share about your experience of sitting up there and listening to these episodes, which I'm very grateful for, by the way.
I just think your podcasts have helped me to be willing to continue to learn about introversion in the workplace and how we can capitalize on the strengths of everybody, not introverts, extroverts, and everybody in between.
Thank you so much. I think that's a great note to end on.
And I appreciate you having the idea to do this today. Maybe in some small way, we've helped a few people out there too.
You never know. But, you know, I go back to your humility all the time, you know, and you had said in your bio, Bill intentionally tried to learn along with his students and probably learn more than they did. So I think your humble attitude and your humility, along with your insights and your different perspectives on what we heard over the last months, is really a bonus. So I'm going to call this the bonus episode. Bill, thank you so much for helping me recap a very intriguing season of The Introvert Ally. You're the icing on the cake.
Well, I don't know about that, Jennifer, but I appreciate the sentiment. And I enjoyed very much talking with you today about this.
And that wraps up our first season of The Introvert Ally. Thanks so much for listening. Do catch up on episodes you missed. And if you subscribe, you will see our next season drop this summer. Also, contact me at jenniferkahnweiler.com or on LinkedIn or Instagram with any thoughts about the podcast. I'd love to hear from you as we shape our next season and invite our guests on. Do take care of yourselves and each other. Thanks again so much.